Good morning. Welcome back. We hope that everyone had a great night of rest and reflection on yesterday's events, and you're ready to continue the important discussion this morning. But before we adjourn back to our breakout rooms to continue the discussion, we have the privilege this morning of hearing from a true practitioner of character development. The guy that is about to talk to us has exhibited character in powerful ways, both as a junior leader in combat, where he earned the Silver Star for his valorous conduct, attributing the actions that day and stating that it was really an award for every single one of the soldiers that were out there and the ones that didn't come home with us. He is now educated as well and tasked with the development of the next generation of officers of our Army. He does so every day as a tactical officer at the United States Military Academy at West Point, where as a TAC, he's considered to be one of the primary leader developers of cadets, assisting each person in his organization, in his charge, with balancing and integrating the requirements of the physical, military, academic, and moral ethical programs. In short, Major Ross Pixler develops leaders of character. He develops leaders of competence, and he develops leaders of commitment, all simultaneously. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Major Ross Pixler.
Wow, I'm really excited to be here today. Although, I got to be honest, with having just heard from Major General James, Colonel Gadsden, Colonel Vermeesch talk, I kind of feel like a three-legged cat on a tin roof at a puppy convention. It was supposed to be a joke. I told my wife I was going to start with a joke, and she told me not to because I'm not funny. So she was right. Chalk one up win for my wife. But I feel completely underqualified to be here and talking to you today, especially on the heels of some really great speakers. But hopefully I can do some justice to some of the thoughts that have been weighing on my mind and some of the things that I came here studying and thinking about. But this is a tremendous opportunity. I'm really excited to be here. Hopefully you are all excited to be here too, regardless if it was your decision or not, right? Because what an awesome opportunity we all have to, in some way, shape, or form, put our fingerprint on potential changes for such a large organization, the Army. What a powerful organization, right? So, tremendous opportunity. And again, thanks to CAPE for enabling and facilitating this opportunity and such a lofty pursuit. I think this is tremendous. And I was in a symposium similar to this back in 2012 at Fort Sill that CAPE was putting on, and I can attest to the validity of the statement that your words, your actions, your deeds, and what you bring to the table today will and can have an impact far greater than each and every one of us. So here's the agenda. I've got 4 hours worth of talking points, and I only have 2 hours to talk. So hopefully we can rush through this as quickly as possible. 3 hours? Okay, I've got a little bit more time. I'll keep it down to 3 hours, though. And we'll get started. So first question I've got for all of you is, do we have a problem? And we kind of talked about this yesterday. Is there a problem? Do we have a character problem in the Army?
Yes.
Okay. Raise your hand if you do not think we have a character problem. Okay. Well, that's a good start, seeing as how we spent most of the day yesterday talking about it. So raise your hand if you think we have a character problem in the Army. DA civilians included. Okay. Some people are choosing not to vote. That's your choice. Nothing wrong with that. But the vast majority believe there's a character problem. Okay. So a quick question. Can we think of any individual or group of small individuals that have caused a large strategic implication on U.S. strategy recently? I already hit the slide, but And these are some just quick things that came to my mind, and I jotted them down. And this is by no means a complete list of significant events, but recently, some high-profile actions. Now, does this mean that we have a character problem in the Army? Were these isolated events? Okay. Could they have been prevented? Were there warning signs? Okay, somebody who rose their hand a little bit ago and said, yes, we have a character problem. What were you thinking about? Yes. Thanks for using the microphone.
Sir, so when I raised my hand for a character problem, you lost. Gotta bring it all the way. So I think that we've lost a character and leadership all at the same time. And we've been making bad decisions from the top down, which enable or kind of let these events manifest because we didn't put a stop to it at the lowest level.
Is there anything particular that comes to your mind?
Knowing the soldiers, knowing the morale and the morale of the unit going on is what came to mind.
Okay. Kind of having that finger on the pulse.
Yes, sir.
Maybe knowing the emotional registry of your subordinates. Okay. Anybody else? Yeah, go ahead. Thanks.
Sir, I also think that the reason we have a character problem currently and the scale that we have it is because with the previous 10 years that we've been in, we've sacrificed quality for quantity when we've needed bodies. And at the, you know, we opened the floodgates to, you know, bring everybody in that we needed to fill the ranks and didn't really screen them like, you know, they used to in the, you know, late 90s.
That's a great point. I saw another hand over here.
I think someone brought it up in the back, talking about starting at the top, sir, like the bad examples of the character problem with, like, General McChrystal and then the AFRICOM commander who was relieved. I can't remember what's his name. For using military funds for his own personal use.
So some high-profile positions, high-profile people also getting in moral ethical dilemmas, trouble, doing what was not right. Over here.
Sir, I think it's promoted through the ranks too quickly.
Okay.
We're not given, I know like several E5s that get promoted to E5 within two and a half years, and I don't think that's enough time to actually be able to build that skill set needed to be put in that position as a leader. And I know E5s that get promoted that really shouldn't even be getting promoted due to the fact that they haven't really stepped out to show their potential as a leader. They just do like one or two things here or there that get them noticed by certain people. And a lot of it too is the good old boy system.
Okay. So just to repeat that, because the microphone things, this is being recorded. So quick promotions, you know, maybe having an inability to accurately promote based off of the right objective criteria that we're looking for in leaders. Okay. Yes. So wait, one more. Sure. Go ahead, sir.
To add to that, the higher up leaders aren't listening to us lower. As leaders on the lower end, when we say that somebody doesn't deserve to go to the board or be promoted, we are being ignored and overridden.
Okay, so feeling like your voices aren't heard, and when you know something that maybe someone else doesn't know about an individual, that might prevent something from happening. Okay, so with the exception of some high-profile individuals getting it and some moral implications, this is not representative of the Army. We would all agree, right? And we can't judge the entire Army based off of a few isolated incidents, okay? But as some of the comments that were brought around here, there's far more than just the major ones that catch global, national news, right? What are some things that happen at our level all the time. And hey, some of the stuff that was brought up in those small group breakout sections yesterday, and some of the things brought in right now today, were some of the things that are just kind of dropping down on the back of my head when I was typing this up. 350-1, right? Have we ever checked a block? Right? Counseling days on OERs. I don't know about you, but have you ever received an OER, an NCOER? It says you got quarterly counseled in this date, and this date. You're like, what? I don't remember that. I wasn't even here on that date, right? Or have you attempted to actually write an NCOER or an OER and say, I did counsel on this date and this date and this date, and it comes back saying, no, we can't accept it because that date you chose to put on there was 2 days outside of the 90-day block of window that it has to be within. So you're going to have to change that date. Okay, but I didn't counsel him on it. This is the date I counseled. No, it doesn't work. You got to have it on the date, otherwise it doesn't get accepted, right? Is that a big thing? I mean, it's clearly not to the same, you know, but is it, are we talking about morals here? Are we talking about ethics? Are we talking about a false report? Accurate evaluations. We were just talking about that, right? Drop weapon. Anyone know what a drop weapon is? Help me out. Get the microphone.
It's a weapon that's not registered or tracked by the military that you carry that you can use and then drop without anybody tracking that.
All right. So either the wrong person was shot or killed, or maybe somebody was shot and killed, but the weapon that they were carrying was moved away, so you have an extra weapon on the side just to place down and say, hey, he was a bad guy. See, he was an insurgent, and this was his weapon, right? Okay. Motor pool operations, we talked about that, handling things in-house. I know no one here knows of anybody in their units that hasn't passed ABCP standards in more than a few months or a year, right? No one knows anyone that's outside of those weight limits that is getting overlooked. Number fudging the data, beer math, the list goes on. A Connex container gets lost, and oh, by the way, we're missing a bunch of stuff that we don't know exactly where it is on our hand receipt, but I'm sure it was in that container, so let's just add it to a loss report. Anyone ever hear that or see that happening? So are these problems that are just isolated, or are these systemic issues?
Systemic.
Right? And this is just a short list. And I'm sure if we combined all of our heads, we could make a very large, large list of systemic issues. But these are small. These are not big things that are creating national headline news. Could they? I was reading a story last week about a brand new soldier that committed suicide after 48 days of being in a platoon where he was constantly harassed, unprofessionally and in some ways very immorally, and took his life over it. They're assuming that was the only cause because they didn't identify any other reasons, any other implications going on in his life. Okay? I actually just talked to a first sergeant who was a platoon sergeant of mine a few years back. I just talked to him on the phone a few days ago, who's got a problem because his company commander is showing his platoon sergeants and his first sergeant naked photos of another captain in the division who he's dating. Okay? Moral, ethical problems going on. So, the question is, can those issues grow into something bigger? Can they become something more profound, more dangerous? And I think that we all would agree that yes, and that is dangerous. My first patrol, first combat patrol as a brand new lieutenant, just got deployed to Iraq. We were in a brand new FOB that had not been constructed yet. We were just living in tents, and we had a nice, beautiful berm around us, and about three quarters of that berm had actual concertina wire on it too, so, which was nice because that was three quarters of our perimeter, you know, secured, right? So one of my first patrols that I received as a platoon leader was to take my platoon and do some cloverleaf counter-reconnaissance patrol around the outside of that perimeter to look for anyone possibly trying to penetrate our lines or, you know, looking at what our posture was. And, I mean, it doesn't sound like a bad patrol at first. Well, let's put things into context because context matters, right? So this is a brand new FOB built on an old Iraqi Republican Guard tank range. What does that tell us about UXOs? They're everywhere, right? And although the ground underneath us was cleared, everything outside of that bermed perimeter is not cleared. And we're tasked with going out at 1:30 in the morning. And there's zero illumination because the moon is on reverse cycle. All right? And we don't have our metal detectors yet. So, now, does it sound like a really smart mission to go on? Not particularly. So what did I do as a normal platoon leader? I went to the boss, the company commander, and said, sir, this is wrong. We can't do this. This doesn't make any sense. This is, you know, there's no point in doing this. We can get somebody really hurt. And what did my boss say? Right, shut up in color. I like that. Okay. And so what did I do? I went back to the platoon, and I said, this is our mission. And what do they say? Hell no, this is stupid. What are you doing? Absolutely. And what did I say? I know, it is stupid. You're right. But the company commander said we're going to do it, and we're going to have to do it anyway. But I tell you what, we're going to go in a file. I'll lead, and we're going to step in the footsteps of the person in front of you. So, you know, if anyone gets blown up, it'll be me. That way we kind of maintain a little bit of security and a little bit more protection. Is that the right thing to do? Well, let's advance forward 2 months later. 2 months later, we're tasked with doing a small kill team, which, you know, is the buzzword at the time in 2007. LPOP is essentially what it was. Six of us up on top of it was a beautiful, blown-out, five-story, big, huge building that had great observation and fields of fire on the main thoroughfare that was constantly getting laced with IEDs and enemy contact. It had a nice, beautiful, abandoned compound with huge walls that encircled this compound right across from us. So we were out there, we had a place to hide our vehicles, and we're up there in our LPOP, listening post observation post, right? And a few hours go by, and we see a little car come barreling down the road really fast. Military HML jumps out, jumps in a bush, car takes off, another car comes from a different direction, stops, the military HML jumps out of the bush, gets in the car, and the car comes right to us and into that abandoned compound, and five military HMLs come out, start pulling out AKs, start pulling out magazines, a cooler, and they're setting up something up, you know, putting up a ladder on the roof of the abandoned compound that we'd already searched beforehand, so we knew there was no one else there. And they're getting everything set up. So immediately, I'm on that radio trying to get my vehicles to go ahead and just block that front entryway of that compound, and we got all five of them detained, secured, game over, win, right? Of course, when do comms go down? When you need them, right? So I got like half of my transmission through, and it's, you know, the crackle, and then, you know, it's off. And, you know, that attempted response from my drivers, like, well, sir? Great. So I send two of my soldiers down to relay that message, get those vehicles moving into position so we can stop them. Well, as we're waiting for those soldiers to run down those five flights of stairs, and clearly these five military males have no idea. We are literally across a road from them watching what they're doing. And two of them get back in that vehicle, start the vehicle up, and it looks like they're about to leave. And I wanted to get all five of them. Right, so I tell my specialist team leader, warning shot right in front of that car into the dirt where the ricochet is going to hit that wall. He could not have done it more perfectly. Right, so as the vehicle is about to exit, that round hit the dirt right in front of the vehicle, right into the wall, just as I'd asked. and it worked perfectly, like a charm. Vehicle immediately pulled in reverse, went back into the compound. And of course, I step forward, and I'm on that ledge, and I'm yelling in Arabic, you know, stop, don't move, freeze, all those, you know, nice buzzwords that they taught me as a platoon leader. And they responded with gunfire right at me, right? So shot all over the place. I discovered later I had a grazing on my side plate. Thankfully, that was it. So I got lucky. Thankfully, my arm was up with the signal for stop, right? Otherwise, if my arm was down, I probably would have gotten hit. So we returned fire, killed two of them immediately. One of them got away into the compound, and the driver and the TC of the car got out and ran into the compound as well. And so they're running out, and we eventually see them on the other side of the building, but inside that big walled area, right? And they are running full sprints in different directions. My soldiers say, sir, what do we do? I said, shoot them. What do you mean, what do we do? They're like, sir, they dropped their weapons. They don't have any weapons. They're unarmed. We can't shoot them. I'm like, yes, shoot them. Sir, we can't do that. And this specialist team leader convinced the rest of them, don't shoot. This is wrong. I did not have the time to explain that you don't become a non-combatant by dropping a weapon and running away. You become a non-combatant by an act of surrender. You surrender by raising your hands up or in some way, shape, or form convincing your opponent that you are giving up to them. Running away is a military maneuver I like to call retreat, regardless if you're carrying your weapon or not. But I don't have time to explain this. I gave an order, and they were concerned that I did not have their trust to provide them with moral, ethical orders. They didn't trust me to provide that moral, ethical order. Why did they not trust me? Anybody?
Were you?
Well, I'd been with the platoon at this point for a while. You know, 3 months before the deployment, and this is about 2 or 3 months into the deployment. I wasn't that new, but I was a lieutenant.
New to the Army, sir.
New to the Army. I would argue it's because I abdicated my authority from the very first patrol. I abdicated my authority when I didn't take ownership over that mission. Now, did they lack trust because they perceived that I didn't have the competence to convince my company commander that this was not smart or this could be done differently or maybe we should do it this way instead of that way? Perhaps. Or maybe they thought that I didn't have the character or the gumption to actually face my company commander and tell him he was wrong. I don't know. That's their perception. But in reality, regardless of what their perception was, I did lack the character to own the mission. I blamed it on hire. And it probably wasn't just one patrol. I'd probably done it a few times between that very first one and what ended up at that shootout. Right? So it's not so easy to identify what right looks like. Sometimes right is difficult to see. What is the right course of action? This quote from ADRP 1, situations of uncertainty occur where the rules do not provide a clear right course of action. You have to base your decisions on your moral principles of the Army ethic. That can be demonstrated through this next slide. And as you see, gotta love it. More technical difficulties, right? That's right. We can still use this slide. We've all seen this slide before. What color is it?
PowerPoint white.
Yeah, I'm not talking about the text. I'm not talking about the text block. PowerPoint white, right? We all know that, right? How do you know it? How do you know it's white? Because you're familiar with it? Because you weren't born yesterday, so you know what white looks like? Right? You ready? Anyone see the difference there? There's the first one. There's the second one. Wow. Am I playing schematics here? Is it the same? It wasn't actually PowerPoint white. I tricked you. Right? That's actually harder to do than you think, because I had to actually make that look like it was the click to add title, which is actually it's hard to get that font right, and then the line, because I had to create that. But to make a point, right? Sometimes, how do we know what white is? How do we know what white looks like? Unless you have some kind of litmus test, until you have something to compare it against, right? Sometimes a slight shade difference can make a big difference. But now we know what white looks like, right? Oh, I tricked you again. All right, so even when we know there's a possible trick, it can happen to us again. Well, let's just do a quick change in words. How do we know what right looks like? Right? If something can fool us as simple and as close as a shade of white, how much more difficult is it for something as intangible as character, as morals, as the ethical code. So, before we can expect to instill, develop, or bolster the trait of character in others, we need to be fully aware of what it means, what it looks like, what it feels like, what it tastes like. We got to be aware of what it is we're trying to create. This kind of reminds me of a couple of quotes. I think Einstein, I could be completely bastardizing this, but I think Einstein said that if he had 90 minutes to save the world, he'd spend 89 minutes defining the problem. I think that's kind of what we're doing yesterday and today. A lot of what we're doing is trying to define that problem. All right? Einstein also said that the pursuit of perfection is far more precious than its possession. Well, that's kind of eloquent, right? But, you know, saying that essentially, are we going to be 100% morally, ethically straight? Are we going to be perfect? Are we going to find perfection in this? Are any of us above having those kind of mistakes? As I just demonstrated in what my first patrols were, no, none of us are above it. We all fall short, but it's the pursuit of finding that perfection that has brought us all here today together. It's that pursuit of getting to a better answer that's far more precious than actually holding it, because we know it's never going to happen. But we can pursue it relentlessly, and we should, for the same reasons as we should not be okay with even the simplest and smallest infraction of counseling OER dates or NCOER dates when it shouldn't be right. So what is right? What do we want? And another question I have, is it okay? Is there such a thing as an acceptable lie? Because I mean, as long as we're talking about this, let's go down this rabbit hole. What is an acceptable lie? Is it ever okay? I'll give an example. A classmate of mine, she was sitting down with her counterpart in Iraq. It was an Iraqi police chief, full bird colonel. And this is one of her first meetings with him, and they're going to be working together for the course of the deployment. Like a year. And he starts asking her about her heritage, because she looks Arabic, right? And so she's looking, scrambling for any way to kind of create those bonds, right, with her counterpart. So starting off on the right foot. And she knows that his background in Shia. He asks her, what's her background? She says, oh, my family is from Lebanon. I have Lebanese and my heritage. Well, they jump off to a great start. It's like, oh yeah, great. So immediate connection happens and flows. In reality, her family is from Israel. Was she going to tell him that her family's from Israel? Knowing a little bit about the context, a little bit about the situation, a little bit about the context, or what would be good or what would be bad for her long term or for her unit long term, she chose to say that she was Lebanese. Is that a right decision? Was it okay? Was it an acceptable lie? Or is this just a form of moral disengagement? I don't have the answer there. Anyone want to take a shot at it? Is there a hand raised? Yeah, go ahead.
I think sometimes, sir, that we all do sort of lie, I guess, for the sake of peace. Sometimes we do that, and I've been guilty of it before. Knowing that the right answer might cause turmoil or conflict, I'll instead, give an answer that would keep the peace, I guess.
Anyone disagree?
Sir, in keeping in line with the Einstein quote that you just used about, the pursuit of perfection being more important than actually reaching it, and I think this sort of falls in line with that. She was in pursuit of the right things, and I think in that context, it wasn't morally wrong for her to lie in that situation. There was greater good to come from that lie than could have come from the opposite. So it was a calculated decision, and again, you mentioned context, and in this context, it seemed to make sense.
I'm sure that if we went all the way around the room, we'd get a bunch of yays and nays. Yeah, Sergeant George.
I think that what was said all makes sense up until the point that he finds out that she's not Lebanese. Then there's an issue. So all that trust that was built up is now out the door.
That's a great point. That's a great point. Yeah, I also on that first deployment that I was on, I was running a traffic control point right on the Diyala River Bridge. If anyone's been around Route Pluto, Vikings, right there doing a traffic control point. And there was an Iraqi checkpoint there as well. And I had an Iraqi major or captain come by and call me by my first name. Wow. How does he know my first name? He also knew that I had a wife and one child. That was kind of eerie. This is a guy I'd never even seen before. Maybe once previously when I did a traffic control point there. How did he know who I was and what kind of information? So I started asking him who he was and how did he know any information about me. And he said he was military intelligence. He could be completely blowing smoke. Maybe he just talked to my interpreter or something. I don't know. But it's a case in point. Can information about your background, get leaked out? Absolutely. I witnessed that firsthand. Well, I don't know if that happened with my classmate's case, but either way, it's a discussion to be had. Because some people would argue yes, some people would argue no. And maybe if I changed the context of the situation, maybe people would be more inclined to say it was okay. Trouble is, where do we draw that line? Is there such a thing as an acceptable lie? What do we teach at Sears School? Right? Maybe that's confidential. I don't know. Yes, go ahead.
Sir, I've always been brought up as, you're only as good as your last operation for Army-wise, and as, coming up as a man, you're only as good as your word. So if you don't hold true to your word, and if you put your character in areas where it can be questioned, you know, you lose all credibility as a whole. So in this particular incident and with this particular criteria, I honestly think it'd be better for your classmate to tell him, I'm come from an Israel or Israelite background, however they say it, because I can find out anything I want on you if I know your name and can find you on Facebook. It's just too easy.
That's a great point. Just to do a little background. Has anyone seen the movie Lone Survivor or read the book Lone Survivor? Okay, so we may be familiar with this. For the people that didn't raise their hand, I haven't seen the movie myself, but I have read the book. What's happened here is that a four-man SEAL team just were compromised in a remote location in Afghanistan conducting a mission, and three goat herders just walked up on their position, identified their location, and they're trying to find this very large insurgent army. So not a good time to be compromised. And they're already having some problems with communications. So what is happening in that video? What kind of decision? Dissension. What is the dissension about? What's the moral argument here? Shades of gray, right? Yes.
I think in the context that you had earlier, as well as the video, your moral ethics have to go in line with not necessarily a lie, but whatever you do, you have to be able to live with the consequences that come from result of that decision you make. So if you actually decide to lie about your heritage, and later on in life it might come out later on, you made that decision. You're gonna have to live with it regardless. So if they killed the unarmed prisoners, no matter what, they have to live with that and whatever consequences comes with that. So your moral is what you're willing to be able to live with for the rest of your life, and also what are you allowed to put on the line for the rest of your life.
That's a great point. And what was the first comment? What was the first thought about why they shouldn't do it? Anyone catch the first reason of why they shouldn't do it?
Bad publicity.
CNN, right? What is that? Fear of reprisal, right? They're putting people in 20 years for, taking back trophy weapons. Okay. So fear of reprisal was the first gut instinct of why we should not shoot. Why should we not kill? All right. Yes?
Is it more fear of reprisal or shaming a nation? So I was just saying, is it more fear of reprisal or shaming our nation?
There could have been some shame of the nation, right? The only reason why I suspect it was more fear of reprisal is because they were concerned about the 20 years of jail time, but or worse, right? But yes, yeah, so with some people, could there have been a shaming the nation? And they also started thinking about other things. Then they started thinking about laws of war, rules of engagement. Okay. But I wanted to point that out because it's going to come up a little bit later, that motivational factors that cause us to decide, make decisions. But it was moral disengagement that was happening, right? We're in disengaging with our morals because of a higher priority to the mission, at least in one person's sense, right? Yes?
I don't necessarily see it as disengaging their morals for a higher priority. What one of the guys was saying is that I don't care about these potential bad guys. I care about you, and you, the other three people that he knows that he's trained with, that he's worked with, that he knows he will do whatever he has to do with. Now, hindsight being what it is, we obviously know what happened. You could argue for or against what they did. Me personally, I'm going to argue on the side of the guy saying, I don't care about those three. Why? Because, as he said, there's an entire army down there. We have a military age male, an elder, and someone who will grow up to be a military-age male. Now, some of us, myself included, have seen children and old men and everyone in between doing things that would make them combatants. Whether or not they were doing it at the time, just because they're six doesn't mean that they're good guys, unfortunately. So I don't see it as a higher priority. He cared more about his friends than these three strangers who very possibly could be bad guys, and more than likely were, in my opinion.
So what we're dealing with is a possibility, potential that there is enemy combatants, right? We're not sure. No one's going to be 100% sure. There's a possibility. There may even be a strong possibility. There's no proof. There's no evidence. As far as moral disengagement includes four components. If you allow me, I'll read them off to you. Reconstruing the conduct, obscuring personal responsibility, misrepresenting or disregarding the harmful consequences of one's actions, and vilifying the recipients of maltreatment by blaming and devaluing them. I would argue that if you break down those four components, that we can check the block on at least three of them, of what they were doing, right? Devaluing them, obscuring responsibility, right? Vilifying the recipients, assuming that they were wrong. Yes.
Sir, the other piece that goes into this is, you know, with the demoralization, is at what point do we become no better than the people we're fighting? Because as a whole, as an army, you know, we pride ourselves on our morals and we always fight for what's right. We always fight, you know, for the little guy. So at what point in this particular discussion, at this particular content, you know, do we become no better than the people that we're trying to stop? And that's something to think about as well.
Go ahead. Yes, Lieutenant.
Sir, it also shows the character of Lieutenant Michael Murphy, of the decision he made. He didn't base it off of his teammates because he knew no matter what, his teammates were going to follow what he said because they had that trust of the bond of him caring for them and them caring for each other. So it just shows the character of him, of letting them go. Sorry if I spoiled it. Of letting them go, even though the outcome was not great in their favor.
Right. Absolutely. We're not saying that all four of them were disengaging morally. That's clearly not the case. But there was some discussion, there was some thought that went into this. And maybe it was a momentary lapse. Maybe in normal circumstances, that wouldn't happen. Right? Maybe normally all four of them are very moral and ethical, but you know, you get placed into a certain circumstance, you get placed into a certain context, and then you kind of mess with the potentialities and you know, what is the likelihood of this person being an insurgent or a Taliban fighter, and you know, it causes us to maybe have some pause. So number one, morally, ethically, we're not all exactly on the same page. And two, context matters. The environment matters. The climate we find ourselves in matters. So all great points. Thank you very much. So how do we assess? How do we assess ourselves? How do we assess our subordinates, our peers, our superiors? Right? I'm not saying evaluate. But if we are going to try to develop ourselves, develop those around us, we have to first identify where we are. Where are we lacking? How do we need to improve? Because if you don't know where you're starting on the map, you really can't orient yourself and navigate to the next point. You first got to know where you're starting from, right? You need to have a compass. You need to know where you are. You need to know where you need to get to go. Right? So it starts kind of with an assessment. And it's really easy, I shouldn't say really easy, it's a lot easier to assess those around you, right? Anybody in the breakout session with me yesterday, we can assess that, you know, new soldiers coming in, They don't have any morals and ethics. They're horrible. They've got no character. They're weak mentally, physically, emotionally, psychologically. I don't know. Not everyone said that, but I heard that a few times. We got problems higher, right? Officers, lieutenants, captains, majors, particularly majors. Man, whew, those guys and girls. Upper leadership, what's big army doing? So we can identify faults in others, but it's really difficult. It takes a lot of social awareness and self-awareness to be able to identify where we're lacking. All right. So how do we change? All right, we kind of started this off yesterday with kind of a baseline assumption, this assumption. It's also supported with a lot of research that moral ethical decisions, behaviors, are a function of the individual character, individual moral character, and the climate or the environment that you're found in, right? Is this true? How can we prove it? Number one, do you act the same way at church as you would at the bar with your friends? Do you talk the same way? Some people might say yes. Right? How many times do you see someone loudly using profanity at Disney World or at an elementary school book fair? Would you? More likely not. Why? Because the social norms would not allow it. It wouldn't prohibit it. The climate that you're in, to a certain extent, dictates how you're going to behave. And somebody who might otherwise talk a certain way in one context might change the way they behave and act in a different context. Right? So the environment matters. What is allowed in that environment? What is the social norm of that environment? Well, what does this tell us about our units? How can we, at our levels, and this takes self-awareness and self-reflection, how can we at our levels influence our environment, our climate, to ensure that we allow or don't allow, we identify what behaviors are acceptable, what decisions are allowed, what decisions are unacceptable. You develop your own climate around you, and people will behave according to what the social norms are that we set as junior leaders. Individual character. This stuff matters. I know I've got 5 minutes left, so I want to close with this, and I think this is important. We all saw that slide that Colonel Vermeesch briefed yesterday that showed the profession of arms, right? It had the picture of the doctors, we had the picture of the soldiers, and around it showed a couple of key buzzwords like ethics, self-policing, regulating, right? Autonomy, and how all that created trust, right? Well, what happens in the Army when we lose that trust? Is there an example? Anyone think of an example like Sharp? What's happening right now with Sharp in the Army? We showed a proclivity that we had the lack of ability to self-regulate, self-police ourselves with respect to Sharp allegations. We lost trust with who? The American people, our elected officials, and what's happening because of it?
Sharp out of our realm, out of UCMJ and into the civilian sector.
We're losing autonomy. That's what's happening, exactly. It's getting pulled away from us. We're losing autonomy. When you break the trust, when you show a lack of ability to self-regulate, self-police, we lose autonomy. Why is this so important? For a second, just imagine what could happen if we show that we don't have the ability to self-regulate and self-police our ethic. What would losing that autonomy look like? So again, why is this important? Why are we here? That's the reason why. Because we need to take ownership. We need to make sure that we don't lose that trust. Because that trust is precious, and it's to all of our benefits. We are professionals, and we need to remain that. Thank you very much.
for giving us a lot more to think about here as we go back in. And I think, at least if you were like me, particularly some of the examples we saw, and I really like that footage from Lone Survivor about that discussion. And I think that problem, while an extreme problem, can be boiled down is what we're talking about in many different problems. I mean, that's an extreme where we're talking about taking life, but that can be applied in any environment for a different question, and that same debate that goes on with each of us. And what I think we found here is that we're all different, right? There are probably people in here, in fact, I think we heard from one, that would have shot all three of those people. There are other people in here, I think that was probably not the right decision. There's probably someone in here that would have found a middle ground somewhere. Maybe tied them up and left them to deal with the wolves if they could have. But I mean, these are the kinds of things that we struggle with in a profession. Really, we didn't get to this yesterday, but in a profession where whether you are on the design, generate, and support side of the profession, an Army civilian primarily, design, generate, and support land power, or on the ethical application of land power for those of us in uniform, the function of this profession at the individual level is to prepare to kill, and to prepare to die and die. If you boil it all down, it really comes down to that. On behalf of the United States of America, everyone in this room has raised their right hand and said, I am prepared to kill and I will kill, and I am prepared to die, and I will die, if that's what it takes. And that is an incredible moral space that we operate in because of that. And so these questions are important, and it's important that we maintain our autonomy to self-police the profession. And that's why we think, whether or not we have a giant character development problem in the Army, or we're just trying to get better at it, I think is inconsequential. We have to do this in order to maintain control of our profession. So thanks for bringing up those thoughts. And we're going to get ready and go back to our breakout rooms here in a minute. Thanks. Everyone, let's give Ross another round of applause.